Good morning, everyone. Today we are going to talk briefly about one national health program, that is the blindness control program, and I shall give you some overview about biomedical waste management in India, which has some updated guidelines. So just for a quick revision of these two topics, because a lot of things are happening in the field of blindness as well as in the field of biomedical waste management also. So we will quickly take 15 minutes to revise these two topics, right? So this is epidemiology of blindness. You may get a full question on epidemiology of blindness, or you get a or you may even get a short note. Okay, so depending on how much text you want to put in, I have given you some broad topics that you can include, even if it comes as a full question or if it comes as a short note. So you may extract relevant sections of that. So these are some old slides, but most of the definitions of blindness remain unchanged, and the program also remains unchanged after so many years. So first you have to begin with the definition of blindness, where WHO has defined blindness as visual acuity of less than 3/60 measured through Snellen's chart or its equivalent. Okay, and for non-specialized personnel, it is further described as inability to count fingers in daylight at a distance of 3 meters. So these are the two standard accepted definitions of blindness across the country, and any person who fits into this due to any reason, is irrespective of the cause, is termed blind. So they further, you might have read in your ophthalmology, because this is something which is overlapping with ophthalmology. So I won't go into the technical details and causes, because already you are reading that as a part of ophthalmology. So we will only talk about the portion which is important from the public health point of view, and you should know how to merge these two together. So this categorization has been given by the World Health Organization, and it is followed uniformly. So 6/18 or better is no visual impairment, maximum less than 6/18 and minimum is more than or equal to 6/60, or a maximum of 6/60 and minimum equal to or greater than 3/60. So these comprise the grade 1 and grade 2 of visual impairment, and these are termed as low vision. Okay, and by definition, less than 3/60 is blindness. So category 3, 4, 5, which include finger counting at 1 meter, light perception, and in the end no light perception also, all these categories, last three categories, fall into the blindness category. So you can begin by describing the problem statement, how much is the burden of the problem in the world, in developing countries, in India. Okay, so if you look at the fact sheet of the world, there are about 285 million people who are visually impaired, and of them 39 million are blind and 246 million have low vision. So it is a huge problem, as you can see from these numbers. What is more alarming is that about 90% of the visually impaired people, they live in the developing countries. So you can easily you can conceptualize, or easily you can visualize that a lot of work needs to be done, a lot of development in the form of identification and early treatment of visual impairment needs to be done in the developing countries. Because you look at the bottom line, 80% of all visual impairment can be avoided or cured. So this is a very preventable disorder, subjected to let's say early identification and prevention. So if the facilities are ample in the developing countries, then these people may be taken care of and the burden can be reduced substantially. So there is a huge role of the programs which are running worldwide, not only in India but also in other parts of the world, especially developing world. And there is a huge role of preventive measures also. So if you look at this, the world blindness map, then the areas which are green, which are mostly the developed countries of the world, they show less than 0.3% prevalence, whereas the red areas, that is usually in the sub-Saharan region and some lesser developed island countries of the world, so they have a much higher burden. Okay, so these areas and these areas, and this is also somewhere the olive green zone. This is also somewhere more than 0.5 but less than 1% prevalence. So most of the other parts of the world, developing countries, they are covered under these regions. Okay, so you can briefly give a map, or you can briefly describe what is happening, what is the situation of blindness across the world. So by region also, there are slides which are available, and you see that Asia, if you can simply remember that Asia has, followed by Africa, has the largest number of blind people, where about 20 million, about 5 million, 6 million. If you can remember these numbers, it is good. So this is the burden of the problem. Amongst industrialized countries, you see it is very less. Okay, so Europe has very less, America has very less, whereas Asia and Africa, which are now you can say that these are more industrialized. Okay, because most of the productions are happening in these two continents, whereas here the finished goods are delivered and marketing and all these things happen. So these are not much industrialized as such, you can say. That is why the prevalence in I would say industrialized countries is higher, where the real industries are there, where the productions are going on, because the labor force is larger and socioeconomic conditions of the labor forces are poorer compared to the other occupations. So Europe, America, they have lesser prevalence of blindness, while Africa and Asia have a higher prevalence. If you look at the global prevalence of blindness, then these are the top causes for blindness. These are mentioned in your books also, so please read them carefully. Cataract, refractive errors, ARMD, corneal scar. This is macular detachment. Okay, so then diabetic retinopathy, then childhood causes, then onchocerciasis, which is river blindness, which does not happen so much in India, but in Africa there are a lot of cases of river blindness. And then collectively there are some other cases from infectious causes, from nutritional causes, and so many other things which are clubbed together in others. So they happen in small proportions, but together they again cause about 11% of the blindness, which is very huge in number. Okay, just after refractive errors we have the collective 11% or all the other causes together. So this is the list, and whenever you are asked to describe what are the causes of blindness or how is blindness prevented, first you are expected to give out a list of the important causes of blindness, and then disease specific, how will you tackle all those causes. Then we go to the problem statement. You can write it down, or you can give a heading, and then always you start with the global problem statement, where you can say that the major causes across the globe are cataract, glaucoma, trachoma, childhood blindness, and onchocerciasis, which happens a lot in the tropical countries, especially in the sub-Saharan African countries. So typically it is a disease of the younger age group, okay, or early older adults, you can say 45 to 59 years, and cataract affects practically everybody above 60 years of age. Glaucoma affects a lot of people who are in this 45 to 59 years age group, as well as above 60 years age group. Trachoma has ceased to become a problem now in this part of the country, because trachoma earlier when we were students, that time trachoma used to be a huge burden. So many people used to come with trachoma because of unhygienic practices, unsafe water, improper facial cleaning and all these things. But awareness and personal cleanliness and these things have gone up in the past decade. So the problem of trachoma, which is related to all these conditions, has substantially come down, and these days you don't see too much trachoma. So, but this is not the situation in other countries. There are still other countries, much underdeveloped countries than us, which have poorer resources, poorer access to safe water, and less education than us. So, trachoma is a significant problem in those countries. So, if you look at the statistics of Southeast Asian region collectively, all countries, they have about 1/3 of the world's blind people, and 50% of the world's blind are children, which is even more alarming because they will continue to develop into blind adults, and the GDP of the country or the workforce of the country or DALIs, however you translate it, are going to be productivity is going to be increased and DALIs are going to be increased. So if you look at blindness in India, then 12 million persons are blind. 90% of them live in the rural areas where facilities for detection and prevention and early cure are less. Okay, incidence of blindness is about 3.8 million per year, new cases per year. So, which is again a huge burden, and these may be due to many, many problems. The problems, let's say, will remain the same as we saw in the previous slide. So the main cause of blindness in India is cataract, and it is more with advancing age in the senile age group, where it is called senile cataract. Okay, but it happens a decade earlier only. So right from the age of 45 years or 40 years also, people start developing cataract due to environmental exposures, occupational exposures, disease conditions, and so many other things. Then there is uncorrected refractive error, which is close to 20%, which is also very, very high. So the provision of early detection and provision of spectacles, okay, to the people who are detected with refractive errors is also quite low compared to the developed countries, where demand is also less, okay, detection is also less, and supply is better. But here, going to the very large population, no government can meet up such large demands in a very short span of time. So they tend to aggregate or increase over a period of time, and then it becomes uncorrected refractive error, which cannot be corrected well. But there is no refractive error which cannot be corrected, so early detection remains a problem. Then there is glaucoma, or increased intraocular pressure, which causes about 6% of the blindness. Then there are posterior segment pathologies like your detachments, retinal detachments, and so many other things, tumors and together. So all these things, they cause about 4.7% or 5%, you can say. Corneal opacity causes close to 1%, and all other reasons like congenital disorders, retinal detachment, tumors, diabetes. Now these constitute close to more than 6%. Now it is very, very important here, these other categories, because you know that diseases like diabetes, hypertension, they are on the rise. Okay, and infective causes are going down, whereas lifestyle disorders impacting various target organs, of which eye is the one of the very important organs to be affected, they are going on the rise. So this others category is gradually increasing and increasing because of improper management of these lifestyle disorders, which include diabetes and hypertension. Then injuries are also increasing substantially every year. So close to 2% of the people, they suffer from blindness which are related to ophthalmic injuries. Okay, so we have already seen all this. You can put it in text. There are state-wise distributions also. Okay, so then you can put about your own state, what is happening here. So we have some old data here, but you can update all this data. This is given in your textbooks. Okay, now why are we talking so much about prevention? What is the need for prevention of blindness? That is that 95% of the cataract treatment saves about 3.4 million blind person years, okay, which is number of blind people multiplied by the years of blindness that they suffer. Okay, so 3.4 million years for blind people are saved if 95% treatment for cataract or cataract surgeries are done. That is why there is so much focus on cataract surgeries. It is single measure to radically transform the situation or scenario of blindness which is happening in developing countries, including ours. So that is why cataract is the number one cause. Cataract can be completely treated by surgery, by intraocular implants. Okay, that is why there is so much focus. So the core of any blindness prevention program across the world, if you see, they will focus on cataract treatment through effective surgeries. So 95% of the refractive error correction, if you are able to achieve that, 95% of the people with refractive errors, if they are detected early and it is corrected through spectacle provision, then about 7.4 million blind person years are saved, which is even greater than cataract surgeries. Because see, cataract is a particular group of people who are going in the senile age group. So there are very few young people who suffer from cataract, and for them the traditional cataract surgery may not work also. But for refractive error, you even see small school children wearing spectacles these days. So this starts very early, and it carries on and it goes on to the adult life. So if they are corrected very early, then about 7.4 million or close to 8 million blindness years for people are saved. Then 90% of the preventable corneal disease and glaucoma, they can be prevented if they can be prevented. Whichever is preventable, if they are prevented, to the tune of 90%, another close to 3 million blind person years are saved. So these are some of the numbers because of which you see that most of the blindness control program, or across the world, they focus on these three strategies, main strategies, apart from other preventive strategies, which we shall see. Then you can describe the epidemiology of blindness, and you can talk about the agents. Okay, so here agents are can be infectious agents like for trachoma, or it can be a nutritional agent like vitamin A deficiency, or it can be environmental agents, it can be increasing age, or it can be other comorbid conditions like diabetes, hypertension. So all this will come into agent and host. So this is a very delicate balance here that you are trying to see where to put agent, where to put host. But overall, you remember that there is a lot to put under each of these categories. Injuries also can be agents. Okay, so in host, you can say all age groups, and then you can describe which are the prevalent diseases in various age groups. Like refractive errors can start from even 5 years of age. Okay, then if you go to diabetes, hypertension, mostly adult age groups are affected. And when you describe cataract, then it is the older adults which are affected above the age group of 45 to 50 years. So in host, age plays a very important factor. Okay, again, if you are describing injuries, then 20 to 40 years of age is the most exposed age group for injuries in various industries and road traffic accidents and in so many other accidents. Okay, so then there is a role of sex also in the epidemiology or causation of various reasons for blindness. And if you see trachoma, conjunctivitis, cataract, so these diseases are reported more in females compared to males. Okay, then you look at the environment. Again, there is a lot to describe in the environment. You can describe by the epidemiological triad that I have tried to show you here to remind that on the top is the host, then we have the agent and the environment. And in cataract, though this is not an infectious disease, not cataract, blindness, this is not an infectious disease as such, but it may be due to infectious causes, it may be due to host factors, it may be due to agent factors, it may be due to several environmental factors also. So in environment you can describe poor nutrition like vitamin A deficiency, there is protein allergy malnutrition related corneal distraction or keratomalacia in severe PEM. Okay, so this can start as early as 6 months to 3 years and 4 to 6 years. So there again you are overlapping something with the age in the host factors as well as in environment. And then you can go to occupation where you can describe cottage industries, workshops, flying objects, factories, gases. Amongst doctors, there can be x-rays, UV rays, which lead to premature cataract. And then you can also describe social class where blindness is almost twice more prevalent in low social classes, mostly because of infectious reasons, because of nutritional reasons, because of occupational accidents, and so many other factors. Whereas in the upper class, this is mostly due to refractive errors and not due to malnutrition or occupations. So there is a gap in the causes for blindness in both these classes. Okay, so this is again one graph. We can skip this for now. Okay, and then these are some studies. Okay, where it was seen that even other factors, you see some of the other factors were also there. Exposure to sunlight, height of the individual, whether it is responsible for blindness or not, okay, it is associated to blindness or not. Then exposure to sunlight, yes, it increases the odds by about 2 times. Okay, systolic blood pressure uncontrolled, it increases the odds by about 2%. Then exposure to fire or dust, okay, this also increases the odds to about 1%, 2%, 2 times. And then if there is history of cataract, this increases the odds of having blindness by almost 5 times compared to the normal individuals. Okay, then other studies also, working hours per day, height. So these are protective. You see, odds ratio is less than 1. So these have been found to be protective. Whereas type of fuel use, systolic blood pressure, exposure to sunlight, all are on the positive side, more than 1. So odds ratio is close to 2 to 2.5 in these other groups. So these are some other risk factors which have been studied in host factors and environment, and they have found associations with blindness. Okay. Now, if you look at the pattern of cataract prevalence in India, then you see that most of the population, it lives in rural areas, but most of the educated youth, they migrate into urban areas, leaving elderly folks behind. So if you can understand this picture, then you will see that most of the infective causes, environmental causes, they happen in rural areas. Okay, then because of lack of health facilities, again preventable blindness in the form of refractive errors also happens in rural India. Because there are more elderly people in the rural areas, so cataract also happens more in the rural areas. So it is the rural areas which get the most chunk of the disease prevalence throughout the country when we compare the rural versus urban areas. Okay, so that is why you see that cataract is higher, blindness is higher, preventable blindness is higher, everything is higher in rural areas. Then you can go to the National Blindness Control Program proper, and you can describe how it was launched in 1976 as a centrally sponsored program. It is still 100% centrally sponsored. And when NRHM was launched in 2005, it was brought under the umbrella of NRHM. So it is a very well organized. Here you can show the involvement of various NGOs and voluntary organizations. You can show the contributions of World Health Organization and various external aids which are available from World Health Organization, World Bank, DANIDA. You can also talk about the government commitment to the program and community involvement also. Okay, so all these things are mentioned in your book. Straight away, don't jump to the program. First, you describe the problem statement, describe the reasons for high burden, describe the environment, describe the agent factors, host factors, and then you can describe giving some social rationale, and then the prevention economics. A lot of stress these days is given to economics. Okay, so I'm not going into details of these goals and objectives. You already know the goal is to reduce preventable blindness to less than 0.3%, to establish an infrastructure and efficiency levels in each program to be able to cater new cases of blindness each year to prevent future backlog. Okay, then objectives, specific objectives are to establish eye care facilities for every 5 lakh population. For establishing, not only establishing facilities, you also need human resources. So to develop human resources for eye care services at all levels, from primary health center to sub-district level. Now, not only you give facilities and you give human resources, you also have to ensure quality. So third objective is to improve the quality of service delivery. All the operations, all the services which are provided should be of good quality. And finally, no program is successful, you know, without community participation. So that is why you have to secure participation of civil society as well as the private sector to report and merge into the government's efforts. So these are specific objectives. Activities which are done, again, they will range across age groups. Cataract surgeries, because cataract is number one. Then for early identification and prevention of refractive errors, you have to do eye screening at schools. Okay, for other conditions, you need eye donations. Okay, you have to provide glasses. Then you talked about increasing the facilities, securing manpower, and provided quality training. So for all that, you have to train the manpower appropriately and strengthen the primary health center so that these services may be provided to the needy people. So these are some activities, but of course, this looks like a very giant goal, and that is why there is a lot of backlog in cataract operations. And you can see that by the age group of 70 years and above, there is a backlog of about 30 lakh cataract operations. Okay, so which also tells you about some of the resistance which happens because of improper education or poorer education related to avenues for cataract surgeries amongst the older rural population. Okay, so then you can talk about the strengths and weaknesses. Here I have listed some of the weaknesses of the blindness control efforts. I don't know whether they are there in your book or not, but you can make this list here. There is no strong political commitment, though it is a centrally sponsored program. It is its accessibility to the underserved population, where it should be better, is less. There is underutilization of available manpower. There is no achieved desired level of prevalence. Okay, we are just saying that it should be less than 0.3, and we are far from 0.3 now. Eye surgeons, though the primary stress of the program is on cataract surgeries, but the number of eye surgeons per 1,000 populations is very less. So they have a lot of load. Okay, it's not that they are not doing, they have a lot of load, workload, which affects the quality of work. So that's why they say that quality of services should be improved by increasing the manpower training and providing the facilities. Then there is inadequate information system about blindness, and there is lack of awareness in the community about preventable blindness. So once blind, they do not know what to do. Okay, though it is hard to believe, but yes, still there are sections in the community which do not know what to do about their blindness. They do not know what is the future course of management, and they remain blind. then there is some role of sentinel surveillance units. Okay, so blindness surveillance is also taken up as a significant section of the program, where under NPCB, National Program for Control of Blindness, surveillance units were set up in 25 selected medical colleges, and they were given financial assistance up to 3 lakh rupees. So their role was to surveil into causes, and the list that we have today, what are the proper common causes of blindness, is through the reports of these sentinel surveillance units. Then later you can talk about the international efforts also for reducing blindness, and amongst that, safe strategy definitely should be mentioned. Now, what is this safe strategy? It was for your, let's say, I'm forgetting, for control of trachoma, which was a significant problem in India. It was a significant problem in many South African countries or sub-Saharan countries, I would say. This SAFE strategy is a mnemonic, actually. So S stands for surgeries, because the infections they caused, trichiasis and entrichion. Okay, so surgeries for all these lid conditions, so that the eye might be widened, aperture might be widened. Then A for antibiotics, because these are infective conditions, so it was said that azithromycin treatment, okay, will help to control the infective condition. So A is for antibiotics. F is for facial cleanliness. So, facial cleanliness by repeated washing of the face and eyes with clean water. So, that was an educational strategy which was then given, and repeated cleaning of the face and eyes with water led to infection reduction, okay, or deposition of infection in the eyes. And E was for the environmental cleanliness and other things. So, for provision of safe water or clean water for cleaning of the face. So, surgeries, antibiotics, facial cleanliness and environment, safe environment. Okay, so this was the SAFE strategy which was given by the World Health Organization, and you see Morocco was one of the first countries to implement this, and this became the first country to achieve its ultimate intervention goals in 2006. Okay, so it was able to control trachoma by 2006. Then other countries, sub-Saharan countries, were also there. So now it is a component. That is the A component, or the antibiotic component, is supported by international initiative in almost 19 countries in Africa and Asia, where trachoma continues to be a problem. Okay, in 2010 data I have, Pfizer had donated about 225 million doses of Zithromax or azithromycin treatments. Okay, so this was the status, but then of course no blindness talk or blindness control talk can end without description of Vision 2020. So you can describe that as it is given in your textbooks. So there is a list of target disease areas for Vision 2020, and they are cataract, refractive error, the same causes list which are known to be the causes of blindness, and they are easily preventable. So that's all in blindness. I'll quickly describe the biomedical waste rules for you. Okay, so again we go to hospital waste management, and this is a relatively simpler topic. The only development is that there are the new biomedical waste management rules, which all of you should know, and they should be mentioned if there is a short note on hospital waste management or biomedical waste management. Okay, so we will quickly rush through this. You know what is hospital waste. You have to differentiate between hospital and healthcare waste. Okay, and then what is hospital waste management? how it will help in reducing the incidence of diseases which can be caused by hazardous substances, by indiscriminate dumping of hazardous substances. So biomedical waste by definition is anything tested or used on an individual or any trash from biological experiments that are medical waste. So it can be generated from healthcare facility, it can be generated from research facility, it can be generated from laboratories. Now why this is important is, again, you should remember that most of the waste, 85% of the waste that is generated from all these facilities are non-infectious. About 10% are infectious and about 5% are hazardous. But the whole 85% which is non-infectious becomes infectious because of indiscriminate dumping, no proper segregation of non-infectious from the infectious. So once cotton soaked in blood is thrown with the foodstuff, the entire thing becomes a hazardous waste. So that is why proper segregation and all these things are very important at the source of generation. Then you can go with the classification of biomedical waste, where you can say that there is general 85% and 10% is potentially infectious and about 5% can be hazardous, chemical or radioactive wastes. Okay, now these are very appropriately, properly they are given in your book. What are sharps, what are pathological wastes, okay, what are pharmaceutical waste, what are radioactive wastes, what is genotoxic waste. So all these definitions you can read from the textbook, and then you can write down these definitions as much as you can remember. Okay, then there is also categorization of biomedical waste which is given in India. So there used to be 10 categories. Okay, there still are 10 categories. So category 1 is anatomical waste, category 2 is animal waste, and the proposed methods of final disposal or treatment of this waste is also described, okay, in a beautiful table. So I am sure you will learn that table for writing down your short notes on biomedical waste management. Okay, so category 7 is solid, category 8 is liquid, 9 is incineration ash, and there is a 10th category also of chemical waste. So this is the table which is given there. So this is as per the biomedical waste rule of 1998. Okay, so in 2016, the latest development is that in 2016, that is 4 years back from now, the rules were amended and new rules came into existence, where the stress is still on the top four blue things. Okay, the stress is still on all those things, but it has some newer avenues also which you should know. Okay, it contains 18 rules, 4 schedules and 5 forms. So the rules are about categories, which are still the 10 categories of the old rule. They talk about segregation, which is still the same, color coding, which is still the same, collection at source, treatment and disposal. All these are described in schedule 1. There are 4 schedules. So all these things, basic things, are described in schedule 1, which are as per the old rules also. Then standards of treatment and disposal for all these waste, 10 categories of waste, are described in schedule 2. Then the prescribed authorities and responsibilities of manpower. Now this is something new. This is described in schedule 3, and labels for biomedical containers and bags. This is also something new which was not there in the older rules. They only had tags or signs for radioactive waste, okay, but now each bag or container can have labels. So this is described in schedule 4. Apart from that, there are 5 forms also. So if there is any accident reporting form is there, application and authorization document are there, okay, annual reporting form is there, and an appeal form is also there. So these are some of the new things which have been described in this one. Now if you look at this, you can categorize according to color coding also, yellow, red, white and blue. Okay, so here it is the same as earlier. Yellow was for plastics, red is for contaminated waste which is recyclable, white is for sharps, Okay, and cardboard boxes are for glassware. These are also for sharps. So earlier also blue was for sharps only. So now they have two categories for sharps. For metals, they have white, translucent, puncture and leak-proof containers, while for glassware, they have cardboard boxes with blue colored marking. So this is a development over the previous rules. Okay, so then there are yellow, red, blue and black bags, which is the same as the earlier. Now in Schedule 4, I told you that there are labels for transportation of biomedical waste, and this is what a typical label looks like. They have to describe the waste category number, waste class, waste description, who is sending, complete address of the sender, complete address of the receiver, date of generation of the waste, and if some emergency happens, if they have to fill the form 1 in case of accidents, then who should be contacted, and so the full name and the address of that person along with phone number has to be provided. Okay, so this we already saw, types of biomedical waste rule in 1998, what are the changes we already saw. So how to collect waste? Through color-coded bags, and all these descriptions remain the same as given in your books. Now then you can describe who are the individuals who are at risk. They are mostly workers who work at the disposal facilities. Okay, then the general public, and specifically children who are playing, poor children who are playing outside healthcare facilities. Rag pickers are at great risk because they do not know what is mixed. So sharps might be mixed up with the general waste, and they are very frequently they are at risk, and they get exposed to puncture injuries or needle prick injuries due to indiscriminate disposal. Okay, then there are medical staff, of course. If the waste is dumped, then medical personnel or nursing personnel also frequently get exposed to all these risks. Okay, and then there are indirect risks to the environment by dumping of healthcare waste in uncontrolled areas. It can contaminate the soil, it can contaminate the underground water table. So if there is incineration, then ash and air can also pollute the environment. So these are indirect risks. So then you can talk about what are the hazards from various kinds of waste. Okay, they can be genotoxic, they can be corrosive, they can be radioactive waste. Okay, and they have the potential to alter the genetic makeup of an individual. So in conclusion, when you describe everything, so please remember, first you have to describe the rules of biomedical waste in 1998. You can describe the classes, categories, ultimate methods of disposal, and then you come to the newer rules of 2016, how they differ from the older rules of 2018. And then sometimes a long question has been asked about methods of disposal of biomedical waste. In those cases also, you have to describe first the rules of 1998, then you have to describe the rules of 2016, and then you go to the proper methods of. First you talk about segregation at source, okay, then you talk about color-coded containers where each waste is packaged, okay, carefully, and then you talk about the labeling. I showed you the labels, and then you talk about how they are transported to the ultimate disposal site, and then only you talk about the various methods of disposal like incineration, chemical disinfection, microwave, land disposal, inertization. So all these methods are described in your books. So please think carefully how you are going to frame your answer for biomedical waste management. So with this, I think we cover, there is mention of screw feed technology also. Waste is reduced by about 80% in volume. So all these technologies, all these things are mentioned in your PARC. While you read, don't just read these things. If a question comes, you have to frame an answer, logical answer, with so that it shows that you are updated with the latest rules. So that's all for today. Before I leave the class and leave you for reading, I have an announcement to make. We have received a list of students who have not paid their due fees. So I urge you, I request you to please clear your fees in time so that administrative hurdles for appearing in the exams are not there for you. I will circulate the list to your CR. You will receive notifications who has not cleared the fees. So please immediately, you all know already who has not cleared the fees. You may have your reasons. So please contact the principal office and clear your fees as soon as possible. Thank you so much and have a nice weekend. Sankranti is ahead. I think I'll meet you only after Sankranti now. So happy celebrations to all of you. Thank you.